This is Duke University.
Welcome. Today we are here with Professor Jason Dittmer from University College London, and we will talk to him about his research and the talks that he has been giving here at Duke. So we will start to ask Jason about his forthcoming book with Duke University Press. The title is Diplomatic Material, Affect, Assemblage, and Foreign Policy. And we are curious, the title is very peculiar for this in the discipline. And could you please tell us about your forthcoming book and why you think it's different from traditional IR theories or foreign policy studies?
Sure, thank you, and thank you for having me here. The book is really kind of a, almost like a counter history of British foreign policy. So instead of a usual history, which is about what Britain has done in the world, it's about the ways in which the world has increasingly become enmeshed in the British foreign policy apparatus. So the first chapter is about traditional diplomacy in the 19th century and the role of paper and how paper actually flowed back and forth and created these connections between countries. And then in the second chapter, I skip to the 20th century and I look at the development of UK-USA intelligence cooperation, which itself kind of today exists through a set of shared databases and also personnel decisions and secondments and this kind of a thing. And then there's a chapter on NATO interoperability, which is about both training people to work together, but also making sure all the equipment from different national militaries works together. And then there's a final chapter about the UK and the European common foreign and security policy and the way in which the UK's foreign office has been sort of enmeshed in that process. So in each kind of historical moment where we're seeing the US becoming, excuse me, the UK being tied into these kind of wider networks of countries, we're really actually also looking at the sort of micro working environments in which this work unfolds, and a lot of which we don't think of as diplomacy. You know, you don't think of, people going to a signals intelligence conference as a form of diplomacy, but there you've got the British and the Americans and the New Zealanders and the Australians and the Canadians all kind of attending and working with each other. And, the shared database itself is a kind of material form of diplomacy, a permanent connection between these intelligence agencies. So theoretically, what I think my work does that is distinct from a lot of other work in international relations theory is to kind of theorize diplomacy as more than just the red carpet and the 21-gun salute and the state dinner, but also to think about the kind of micro contexts in which these foreign policy apparatuses are constantly interacting with one another. And if you start from that context, then you can imagine kind of affects and influences bubbling up, you know, from the ground level all the way to what we would think of as proper diplomacy.
Okay, no, that is a very good summary. And also it explains why it's such an original work. And so thank you very much. But you have been working on this book and this research for several years. You have been using different type of sources. What type of sources have really informed this particular research, the book, and how do you apply, there are two questions. How do you apply the results of your research to foreign policy and when you advise policymakers? What is different from traditional advice?
Sure. In terms of the methods that underpin the book, I would say that really the two major ones are archival research, kind of going into key moments in British history in which the country is being kind of enmeshed in these kind of permanent relations, which is, I think, something that we can see really developing over the 19th century and the 20th century. And we're obviously still living in that world today. So the archives are really full of these kind of really interesting moments that I think most, scholars of international relations would tend to gloss over, the ways in which everyday life unfolds in these institutions as they're being set up, and the way in which these institutional setups are meant to produce certain kinds of power in the world, right? But they also unleash these other powers which we're sort of less attentive to. So I think as an example, one that I think most people get in diplomacy is the idea of rotating diplomats around, which if you think about it is entirely counterintuitive because you would want to have people to have expertise in a place and develop that over time. But there is this idea that once these people are enmeshed in relationships in a host country, that they start to think more and more like the people from that country, which on the one hand is good, but on the other hand, they may eventually start to think more like them than like their host or their country that sends them, right? So you move them around so as to kind of keep them from going native. I think what it does is it offers up the opportunity for policymakers to pause and think about the influences that are shaping their kind of decision making. The talk that I'm giving is called The UK and the World and the UK. And because the idea is that normally we think of foreign policy as emerging out of the Department of State, Foreign Office, these kinds of places, and going out into the world. It's about, in the case of my study, Britain acting in the world. But assemblage theory really points us to think about how the world is already inside the Foreign Office or the State Department, how your allies and their views and these kinds of things are often internalized already. And that's not necessarily a bad thing, but it does kind of give policymakers the chance to stop and think about the ways in which they want their ministries to be connected with one another and to be attentive to these kind of wider forces like affect, which I would never go to a policymaker and tell them to be aware of affect. That's a kind of jargon that they would probably throw me out for. But that you can start to think about the sort of embodied context in which policymaking takes place, right? The buildings, the institutions, the material connections that connect you to other institutions, the shared databases, these kinds of things that you share with allies, data, information, particular spaces, and that itself kind of shapes the context in which foreign policy is being made.
And do you think, because you have been working in the British archives, which other countries you are interested in, and because Great Britain has a particular history in terms of international relations, is your theory applicable to countries which are, let's say, emerging markets or countries that do not have the same tradition in terms of diplomacy and foreign policy?
Sure. I mean, I think it's equally applicable everywhere, although certainly, as you say, you have to actually look at the material connections in every particular place. And Britain, like America, is kind of highly enmeshed in these webs of relations. At the other end is probably a country like North Korea or polities that are kind of quasi-states, something like Palestine, right? These kinds of things are obviously going to be very specific cases. But there is, there is no country that is an island, well, except for the island countries, but you know what I mean? Everybody has relationships of one form or another, and they are going to shape the way in which foreign policy gets made. Okay. So it's not the same story in every place, but
sure,
the same theory
can
absolutely make it there.
And now, because you are in London, Great Britain, there is a lot of talk about Brexit. From your point of view, what's next in the sense, is it something that is going to change the way Great Britain or the UK conducts its foreign policy forever, or is it something that it's a transitional period? Certainly, the UK has been detached from some European Union policies, especially in terms of foreign policy. But what do you think about the situation and about the future?
Sure. No, it's directly relevant to the book. My fourth kind of case study chapter is all about the way in which the British Foreign Office and the European External Action Service were kind of enmeshed with one another, both over time and then in the current situation. So I'm keen for the book to get out before Article 50 gets triggered, as that chapter will date quite quickly. But yeah, I mean, I think that's exactly the kind of situation that the book is kind of designed to deal with, that what you have are deeply enmeshed institutions, where British diplomats go and serve in the European External Action Service, come back, and there's this permeability between the institutions, and the way that their meetings are lined up are are coordinated so that British foreign policy gets made in advance of this, but also the embassy in Brussels or the representation in Brussels is constantly feeding back information. There's intelligence flows between Britain and the EU. You know, and a lot of those are going to get severed. And so I think it is a period of real ferment, you know, and I think you can see Britain at the moment kind of trying to figure out exactly what its new footing is going to be in the world. They will still, of course, have strong relations with EU countries for the most part, although you'll probably see some divergences there. But, you know, they are, I think, going to be looking to, you know, extend the relationship with the United States and also to try and find other new key allies around the world.
Right, and I know there is some talk nowadays of strengthening the relationship with Commonwealth countries. I mean, they've always been strong, but now to rethink about the relationship with Commonwealth countries, and is there, what is your think about that? Because this actually will play into what you just said, that they are rethinking about, not new, in this case, old alliances, but maybe thinking about those alliances without the European Union.
Yeah.
And so, no, it's interesting. So, and now there is another set of research that you have been doing and labeled under Captain America. And you gave this interesting talk on Trump and Captain America. Would you mind to summarize why Captain America and why Trump and Captain America?
Sure.
And what is your interest in this topic?
Sure. The talk is really kind of in two parts. And so in the first part, we're thinking about the history of superhero culture in America and the sort of way that's become a political idiom that kind of everybody understands, and it carries with it a certain logic about power and masculinity and the legitimate use of violence, and you know that as superheroes have come to dominate American culture, that kind of increasingly becomes a way in which people can think about the presidency, you know, and I think Donald Trump clearly kind of speaks to some of these idioms of the superhero, right? So and both in positive ways and in negative ways, right? So I was struck in the wake of the election how my Facebook feed was filled and my Twitter feed were filled with images of people with Trump as Captain America, right? As the hero who will sort of liberate us from bureaucracy and inaction and weak leadership and that kind of thing. And equally, people filling my feeds with images of Captain America fighting the alt-right, beating up Nazis, and you know, so Trump was sort of simultaneously proto-American and the antithesis of that, right? And so I thought that was a really interesting thing that was worthy of kind of teasing out. So that's the nature of the talk. It may seem a long ways from assemblage theory and foreign policy, but actually the kind of one thread that goes through my entire research career is an interest in trying to think through international relations from the kind of everyday up, right? So instead of thinking about events in foreign affairs or international relations as being exceptional, grandiose things, right? That instead they're underpinned by sort of vast infrastructures of culture and bureaucracy and kind of everyday people going about their lives doing everyday things. So my study of Captain America and the book that came out of it is about thinking through the evolution of this idea of the nationalist superhero, a superhero that's associated with the country, and which I think, you know, increasingly it's clear that this is something that people connect with and use to make sense of international relations. And the current study with the book Diplomatic Material is about kind of everyday life in these institutions and what it's like to be at work in the UK-USA intelligence relationship. Sure. You know, what does it mean to be an NSA employee in everyday life trying to, go about your job with your relations with the British? What does it mean to be at NATO headquarters having lunch in the cafeteria surrounded by all the other members of NATO having lunch? You know, is that diplomacy? Is that not diplomacy? Or is it just lunch among friends, right? Mm-hmm. So we kind of have to think about diplomacy as not just a state dinner or Donald Trump and Shinzo Abe at Mar-a-Lago, but instead about kind of all the ways in which states are constantly enmeshed with one another, either materially through databases and that kind of a thing, or via the kind of, yeah, just people having lunch.
And in terms of, I know it's a tough question because we are just talking about a forthcoming book, but I'm sure you are already working on a new project. What is your next project, and is it connected to what you just explained about Captain Trump and America, Trump and Captain America, and or the book?
It's really building more on the current book. There's a chapter in there that's about NATO interoperability, which is the topic that I found really interesting because it's about the way in which the military equipment and the soldiers and the airmen and the sailors all have come to be kind of trained, or people are trained, and the technology is crafted in a way so that it all works together, right? Which is an incredibly complex process because these militaries are constantly evolving in their equipment and whatnot, and so they all have to be made to evolve together. And so I was really kind of captivated by that case study, perhaps most of all. And so I thought I would carry it on in a kind of particular realm and kind of go deep on it. And the topic is a project called the Global Network of Navies that's been kind of kicked around in the Pentagon for the last 10 years. And it's basically about creating interoperability among all, you know, if not all the navies of the world, a set of key partners all around the world, so that the U.S. Navy can interact with these people in crises, or they can interact with each other without the U.S. Navy during crises, whether they're humanitarian or military or disasters, you know, tsunami relief, this kind of a thing. And I just think that is such a fascinating project. It's huge. Whether or not it ever comes together is a whole open question, but I thought I would at least get in on the ground floor and try to do a study of that.
Thank you. And I will ask you another question, which is our last question. And this is tough because we are talking about the future, but since you study IR, political geography, foreign policy, and we are in a very particular, we are living through a very particular time. It's always a very particular time, but in this moment there are a lot of changes in terms of alliances, or the US and other countries are rethinking about alliances, the emergence of China, India, and certainly Russia asserting itself. Just based on your research and your observatory in University College London, how do you see how is the international order evolving? Mm-hmm. And I'm not asking you to make any prediction, but just your feeling about what's going on and what's next.
Yeah.
It's a tough question.
No, it's a tough question. History will prove me wrong, undoubtedly, but I'll at least take a shot at it, which is, you know, what I think we're seeing and why I think you see so many of the various kind of establishment figures in the West so distressed by everything that's happening is because I think what we're seeing is the unraveling of the West as a sort of geopolitical assemblage. You know, this web of connections that I kind of document in the book in a lot of ways is the emergence of a kind of, you know, quasi-civilizational actor, which we all come to know as the West. And I think what we're seeing, or at least the possibility of seeing, between Brexit, between at least some of the things Donald Trump has talked about doing, whether he will end up doing them is a separate thing, his particular warmth towards Russia, his aversion to China and Mexico, and, you know, a lot of kind of
traditional
positions. You know, as I think we're going to see potentially a lot of these relations that the book is about kind of being unpicked. You know, literally my fourth case study is is going to be disappearing. The question is whether the one on traditional diplomacy, whether the one on NATO, the one on intelligence cooperation, if those kinds of things are going to be unraveling. Whereas really for decades, the direction of travel had been towards more and more blurring of these boundaries between various states. And I think what we're seeing is, you know, those relationships being picked apart.
Right. It's also the end of the post-World War II order. Mm-hmm. And of course, we don't know yet what's next. And hopefully it's not another war. But certainly it is a new generation of leaders and the rise of populism, not only here, but also in Europe and other parts of the world. So certainly the next 5-10 years are going to be very different from what we grew up with, and of course there are a lot of uncertainty. So
yeah, hopefully I think if I could build on what you just said, I mean, you know, it's interesting. I'm thinking this through as you were talking. One of the, you know, so I have the NATO interoperability chapter of my book, which is all about the development of NATO, you know, how they negotiate about what should be interoperable and how it should be interoperable. But then the end of the chapter is really about the way in which they kind of globalized these standards after the end of the Cold War. So it wasn't just NATO developing interoperability, but then the world generally adopting NATO standards. And with intelligence cooperation, you see the same thing. Right. It starts with Britain and the UK, and they come up with the formatting, the technology, the way in which intelligence is going to be shared. And then they kind of impose that with restrictions on their allies. So everybody has to kind of play by the US and the UK's rules, and they get a, you know, 60% access or 75% access or whatever. But so you've seen, if you will, the globalization of Anglo-American intelligence standards. You know, and I think if we're looking at this kind of unraveling of the West, we're partly talking about this kind of geopolitical block, but we're also talking about these micro standards, which had been a lever of power for Britain and the USA all around the world for decades now. And you can see that in other spheres, like you know, the US dollar being a sort of global currency, et cetera. All these ways in which, kind of through micro exchanges, power has been exercised all around the world. I think we're going to see potentially a lot of that unraveling. And that might be, you know, a sort of tipping point phenomenon where we might kind of be watching the world proceed as it has been for a while, and then once the standards get undone to a certain point, then all of a sudden it becomes a much more free-flowing situation with, obviously China is well positioned to benefit, Russia thinks they'll benefit as well, you know, but you'll see kind of a lot of questions that had been closed for a long time being reopened. Right. And very quickly you could see Anglo-American power kind of dissolving.
Right, or at least changing, yes.
Yeah, okay. Absolutely.
Okay, thank you very much. It was really nice to have you here for a couple of days and giving so many interesting talks and meeting with students. So we hope to see you again, and congratulations on your new book.
Thank you, and thank you for the invitation.
You're welcome.